some places. I mean, montage is necessary for doing something. So, this is the second week. Last week we talked about the cave allegory.
Yes.
You asked some questions. I hope you received your answer. And if you don't understand anything about the cave allegory or other things, please ask me. And when we are talking about cave allegory, remember that cave allegory is not such a thing in which some prisoners are in front of the cave wall and just seeing the shadow of the puppets. Cave allegory is a kind of human situation. It is about the human condition. So we are creating our caves now. Remember?
Yes, I remember.
So in order to understand the relationship between philosophy and cinema, first of all, we need to emphasize this point, cave allegory. And there are some movies which emphasize this cave allegory. Maybe you have watched the movie which was created by Stanley Kubrick, Clockwork Orange. Clockwork Orange. Have you seen it?
No, not yet.
In Turkish, it is translated like this, Automatic Portakal. The topic of this movie is like this. There is a person whose name is Alex. Alex set up a gang group. Gang, I mean, chete. And he creates some problems in the city. He harms people, the one of the scene in the movie is like this. He knocks the door and he enters the house, and there is a family. This family is comprised woman and husband. The woman was raped by this group. But one of the interesting points that I want to say is this. While this group was raping this woman, the man, the man was forced to lie down on the ground, and a small ball is put inside the mouth, and he is forced to lie down, but his head is like this, and he doesn't need to look at the action, but nevertheless he opens his eyes. And so at this point we have to ask this question: why he is opening his eyes? What is happening here? So, this is the question about cave allegory. In the cave, we are living in phenomenal world, appearances. There are some appearances, and also there is an ideal form, and there is an ideal world. Ideal world and appearance world is different from each other. So, in the world, we think that we see the objects as they are. But we never ask this question: do we really see the objects as they are? Or there are some blind spots, there are some blind spots of mind which curb us to see things as they are. So, the man, the husband, is seeing the raping, but we should ask, why is he looking at this raping event? Why don't close his eyes? Does he look at the raping real? And what do you make a comment about this? This situation. Do you have any comment? Did you understand what I want
yes.
to say?
There is a possibility that he's looking at the event, but he's not looking at the event. Maybe his mind is somewhere else.
Is there any possibility? Is there any other possibility for looking at the raping? She says that okay, maybe he thinks that he is looking at the raping. Maybe his mind is elsewhere, somewhere. Maybe he doesn't focus on the raping.
Yeah.
But remember that in the lesson last week, we talk about this issue. And an interaction in social theory or media. Did you remember it? I gave an example from Plato. There was a character whose name is Leontios. Leontios walking on the corpses, dead bodies. And there is a conflict with his eyes and his reason. His reason doesn't want to see the dead bodies, but his eyes says the different thing. His eyes want to see the dead bodies. Did you get it? And his eyes want to see dead bodies, whereas his reason says the opposite. His reason says that don't look at the dead bodies, because there is an act of violence here. There are so many dead bodies over there. It is unhuman. I mean, it is inhuman seeing the dead bodies. But his eyes want to see dead bodies. What is the paradox here? Is there any paradox here? What is the relationship between this situation and the cave allegory? Okay.
I think it's a challenge between a person's logic and emotional part of their brain. In reality, he is not tend to see the persons who do something with her wife, but in his logic and in his, in his reasonably, he wants to know that if his wife also watching his husband or not, her husband or not. He wants to know his wife's reaction. I think it might be. One reason why he never closed his eyes. What's his wife's action? Is she watching her husband or not? I think
this is another comment. But as you see, there is a paradox here. There is a conflict between our emotion and our reason. Emotion wants to do something else. Reason wants to do something else. And Plato claims that we are living in accordance with our emotions or passions or opinions. But reality is not upon the opinion or emotions. Reality is based upon the reason. So maybe you understand what I want to say. The Levantius, this soldier, was walking on the ground outside the city by seeing the dead bodies. There is a conflict between the seeing and not seeing desires. So, if you ask this question, this problem to Plato would have answered like this. As you see, we are living in a cave situation. Cave is a human situation. Rather than by putting our reason, we are just doing actions according to our emotion. Did you get understood? Did you get it, what I want to say?
Yes.
Okay. So, cinema is an art. in the text, I touched many issues. But first of all, I started my debate by talking about the meaning of thinking or thought. By the way, I wrote down here a thought, but today I thought that I thought it is very paradox. I thought about the difference between thinking and thought. Do you think that is there any difference between thinking and thought?
Thinking and thought.
Yes. Actually, you made me aware of the fact last week. You said that düşünce can be translated into English thinking. And I said thought. And today I thought that I think there is a difference between them.
Thinking
what kind
and
of
thought.
Difference? Yeah, thinking and thought. Can you make a sentence about it? We say that I am thinking. But on the other hand, we say that thinking is one of the best options for human being, for example. We say that human being is thinking animal, for example. So, what is the difference between them?
Thinking and thought.
Yes.
Maybe thinking is a situation you are trying to bring a new thought in your brain.
Mm.
And thought is already there.
Mm.
I think so.
Thinking, I think it's a continuous process. And thought is maybe you already have a stand about a particular thing. Like you've already made, I think it's like thinking, it's like this, then thought is, it's at the end. Thinking is the process while you are trying to make, it's the process where you are trying to come to a decision about a particular thing, then thought is like the end product or something like that.
I agree with you.
Yeah.
Yes.
I agree. Thinking is a process. Thinking is becoming. Whereas thought is a condition. It is a condition. It is like stopping some things. So actually, I want to clarify thought in the meaning of thinking in my speech, actually. So I think we should change the thought as thinking. Thinking, yes, this is an active process.
Yes.
So we should talk about the meaning of thinking. What does it mean? And in my speech, I started to talk about thinking. What did you understand while saying thinking? Did you read the paper?
I read it, but
it is a heavy issue.
Yeah, it's kind of, because you give some examples from some movie scenes.
Yes.
And you spoke about ethical regime. You spoke about, I can't really remember, I wrote it down. Is it ethical regime, aesthetic regime? I don't know if it's a little bit far from that thinking.
But you passed some topics. I mean, you got into the details of details and philosophical, big philosophical issues. First of all, we should talk about human being. What is the capability of the human being? What kind of capabilities do we have? And Immanuel Kant classified the human capabilities. What kind of abilities do we have?
We have the ability to like feel, have the ability to think.
Okay.
We have the ability to make decisions. We have the ability to, he made a lot of
actually
samples.
The four categories.
Yeah.
Four categories. I mean, you can say many things, but you can, put these categories under one title. For example, understanding. Understanding is a faculty of human being. Understanding. We understand many things. All human beings have these capabilities. No matter how much no matter how you are in different nations, different classes, different races, it doesn't matter. And the second faculty is, you know, feeling pain and pleasure. Feeling pain and pleasure. Actually, not only human beings, but all the animals, all the animals have these faculties. I mean, feeling pain and pleasure. And imagination, you know, imagination. Imagination, when we are saying imagination, what do you understand? Imagination. Did you think over imagination?
Imagination.
Yeah, imagination. Imagination, what does it mean?
Imagination, could it be like, I don't know how to phrase this, but you know, every human always wish they have a second life, like a sort of life they have always wanted to have, but they can't live that life because they are actually living this one. So every human being kind of like picture a type of life they would have wished to have in, I don't know, imagination. I don't know how to explain it in my own terms, but I understand what it is. Maybe you can elaborate about this.
It is very difficult to explain some things. When you try to explain some things, it is like sleeping in your hands. It's like, you know, flying from your hands. You cannot catch some things. But when you talk about imagination, we can imagine some things. You know, imagination is like connection with different ideas. You know, we see many sculptures made during the ancient times, ancient Greek, for example. And also we know that 30,000 years ago there were some sculptures which were not in connection with reality. What kind of sculpture? For example, a human body with a lion head. There is a lion head and then human body. In the reality, is it possible to see to this kind of body?
No.
It is impossible.
Impossible.
So, how did people create this sculpture?
By imagination. Yes.
They saw different parts of things, on the one hand animal, on the other hand human being, and they combined these parts in their imagination. And also we dream many things at nights. This is imagination. And when I ask some question, and then while I'm talking about some things, you imagine the things that I talk. Imagination is the basic faculty of human being. And there is a relationship between imagination and cinema. In the future lessons, we will talk about, we will touch this issue. Okay?
Okay.
So, now that every human being has these faculties, does it mean that everybody is thinking? What are we talking about? What are we discussing? Did you understand what I want to say?
No.
I mean, everybody has these faculties, okay? Imagination, knowing, understanding, feeling pain and pleasure, and everybody knows some things. Everybody understands what I want to say. So what are we talking about? What are we discussing? As you remember, in the first lesson we touched this issue, thinking, and in the second lecture, in this lesson, we just try to understand the meaning of thinking. So, what is thinking? can we say that everybody, now that everybody has these faculties, can everybody think? Is everybody thinking? Is there any difference between thinking and opinion? Let me ask a question. How do you feel today? Depressed.
Yes.
You say that, you can say that, I am depressed. It is subjective feeling. Okay?
Okay.
Do you think that this is thinking?
No.
Why? You express yourself.
Thinking.
Mm-hmm. Good. How do you feel today, Abdul?
So-so.
Hmm?
So-so.
So-so. Okay, so-so. So-so. So is this expression thinking?
I think it's an opinion I have of myself today.
Mm-hmm.
Well, like, maybe someone might be seeing me another way, but how I see myself today is that I do not feel good. I do not feel either good or bad. So I feel, is this, I don't know if it's a thing, but I think it's like an opinion I have of myself today.
Mm-hmm. So, what is your answer?
I'm good.
You are
I'm
good.
In a good
okay.
But mm-hmm. when she says I'm depressed, so-so, and good, others can hear. For example, she says, I'm depressed. I understand she's depressed, but I can never feel her her feelings.
Mm.
I think the difference between opinion and thinking can be like this. For example, I say I'm good.
Mm-hmm.
Everybody knows I'm good, but mm-hmm. nobody can feel how I am good. For example, I explain you, yes, I'm good because I have a good day. It happens some good things to me. You can just hear, but you never can feel what I feel. I think the difference between opinion
okay.
and thinking can be like this.
Yes, there are some differences. Between experiencing and also saying some things. But everybody has faculty to express himself or herself. So according to research, according to debates and philosophical discussions, these are not thinking. These are just simple ideas or subjective feelings. Okay? This is the first point. And also, in the cave allegory, remember that prisoners are talking about the shadows reflecting on them. Shadows, okay? So, there is another expression that I would like to say. For example, I can see some papers, some recording device and a book, and I can say, okay, there is a table over there, on it there are some papers, a recording device and a book. And when I ask this question, what are they? And you can answer easily. Is there, don't you need to make an effort, big effort, to say like this? It is an empirical thing. It is like shadows, okay? Shadows. It is reflecting things. So, I hope you understand that the basic point to start with thinking is about the difference between opinion and thinking.
Yeah.
Okay? So, and also, at this point, it turns out another question. Do you watch television?
Sometimes.
Sometimes. Do you watch television?
Sometimes.
You?
Yes, sometimes.
Okay. What kind of programs, what kind of content do you prefer to watch?
Mostly sports.
Sports. What kind of sports?
Football.
Football. Oh, mass sport, huh? Mass. So, you, what about you?
Series.
Series, good. Turkish series?
Sometimes.
In order to improve spoken Turkish?
Exactly.
And that is one of the best way of
improving
spoken Turkish. Many Iranians learned Turkish by watching Turkish series.
Yes.
And they are speaking ideal Turkish. Maybe. So, do you watch some discussion programs? I mean, some professors, some academics, some intellectuals, some specialists on TV, on screen, they are gossiping, they are discussing many big, heavy issues. For example, on CNN. On CNN, you know?
CNN, yeah.
If you have any question, you ask this question to a professor or academics.
Yeah.
And he is debating the issue. Do you think that this discussion thinking?
Yes.
What is the evidence of it?
Can you repeat the question, please?
Do you think that these debates or discussions done by academics and intellectuals on TV thinking?
Yes.
Or opinion?
It's a little bit tricky question.
Yes, I am asking difficult questions.
Zekiye
answered thinking.
Yeah.
And I am asking Zekiye why?
Because, for example, if someone asks a question, that professor has to use some effort to give an answer.
Okay.
So that's supposed to be thinking, not just a normal opinion.
Okay. Let me ask this question. Is there any difference between the these professors talking about some issues on TV and the discussions on books by some academics? Or the discussion at the classroom, at the university. Is there any difference between them?
Yes, there is a difference.
What kind of difference? Can you give some examples or can you clarify this point?
Because on television, maybe you might get unexpected questions.
Okay.
It's different from writing and discussing your points on a book. You might write what you want to write. When you're giving a lecture in a school, you might give a lecture of what you want to give about, unless someone asks you an unexpected question.
Hmm.
So the discussion is totally different, I think.
Good. What is your answer?
But I think your first question, you say these debates they do have on TVs, do you think whether it is thinking or opinion? I sort of feel it's his opinion, because when someone asks a question to someone, he's not actually asking for their thinking. I think he's asking for their opinion to have an answer or to have a guidance or something like that. So the person gives their opinion they give their own opinion about that particular topic the person has asked to that person. So I don't think it's, though there is a fine line between, in this matter, between thinking and opinion, but in my point of view, I think it's opinion he's giving to that, like the answers or the doing those a bit, they are giving their opinion to, they are airing their own view, because I feel they've maybe read it from somewhere before, or they've come across it before, and now they have harnessed it, and they're giving their own opinions, I think.
Mm-hmm.
I think in lectures or discussions, when the lecturer is speaking, one audience wants to ask a question. So, in his mind, an audience makes some comparison between the lecturer's opinion and his thoughts. And this comparison makes him or her to ask some questions. And sometimes we see that that person starts his or her question like this. In my opinion, or I'm thinking, you said that, you said this, and opinion and thinking are in challenge with each other. Shall I?
Okay.
I think in an lecture, both of them are happen, both thinking and opinion. For asking a question, I have to compare your thoughts and my thoughts. Then I ask you a question.
Yes, you are right. You are partly right. I agree with you. But there is a sociologist whose name is Pierre Bourdieu. Pierre Bourdieu is a French philosopher, French sociologist. And he says they are fast food thinker. Fast food.
Fast food.
By saying fast food thinker, I am sure you understand the meaning of fast food thinker. What is the speciality of fast food? It is standardized. It is the same. It has to be fast. You never have to contemplate over it, or mediate over it. And I think he is right. We are saying many things, or academics or intellectuals are saying many things on TV. But when you are aware of the of this talking, you understand that they are very similar with each other. Like they are produced from this same machine. And you can meet these ideas every time, okay? And they are speaking very fast. If you are aware of their talking. So the thinking that I want to touch is not thinking that I want to talk. There are some differences between my thinking concept and fast food thinkers concept. Fast food thinkers thinking. Did you get it?
So the fast food thinkers always have the same
thinking all the time. Similar things, and also their answers are unexpected answers. They are expected answers. You cannot be amazed at when you hear this thinking. You are just, it is a kind of routine activity. You turn on television, and there are many images flowing in front of us, and programs are following each other consecutive way, and academics or intellectuals are answering many questions in a short time, and they are expected answers. Why? Because they know that they are addressing to millions of people, and they have to check out, they have to control themselves, they have to suppress their feelings. And also every day the more they hear the same ideas, the more they make an effort to spread the same ideas. Every time, every day, everywhere, you face the same ideas. But when you look at the books or different lectures, you can be amazed by the ideas. Some ideas. You can be surprised, you can be shocked. So this is the difference of thinking. Thinking that I want to say from the thinking produced by the fast food thinker. I hope you got it.
Yes.
If you have another question about this issue or other issues, please ask me. So, the third point from this, we can pass into another subject about the discussion, about the thinking subject. So, in my opinion, it is very paradoxical expression when I say that in my opinion, because I am against opinion when I talk about thinking. It is routine activity. It is routine expression. It is like automatical way of thinking. Actually, I am against this. So, I reached a conscious while I was saying opinion. I mean, I said that, okay, in my opinion, suddenly I made aware of the fact that I was making a mistake. This is conscious. This is consciousness of human being. This is another point. So, it means that in daily life, we are activating or we are acting. We are acting according to our subconscious level or at automatic level, automatic way. You are sitting here and you are writing some things these activities are like automatic. Everything is designed according to the algorithm of the body, you know. When you are swimming and sometimes you cannot think what you are doing. If you think that you are swimming, you can sink. This is another. You are riding a bicycle, okay? First of all, it was a technical process. Sometimes you dropped, you injured, but over time, when you learn how to drive, how to ride a bicycle, and this riding bicycle became automatic process. You are not thinking how to ride a bicycle. When you think over it, you can drop. Okay?
Sure. So, does this have anything to do with in the paper? When you were asking that, do we really see the reality?
Yes. So, this is the third point that I want to say. And I want to pass into this subject. That is why I gave these examples. Do we see the reality, objects, or ourselves, or others, as they are? Or are there other mechanisms or blind spots which curb to see the objects, other peoples, and other ourselves? So I think when we are aware of the fact that we are perceiving some things, this is thinking. Thinking means, in my research, in my readings, thinking means to see, to perceive, to understand something or someone as they are.
Thinking.
Yes. So it doesn't need to make an effort to reach the thinking level. Sometimes we think that thinking is a philosophical case, philosophical situation. But I am against this idea. Everybody can think in different ways, in different thinking modes. Let me give an example. You know, in human history, we passed some stages, and 90% of human history belongs to hunting-gathering society, hunting-gathering period, you know?
Yes.
hunting, gathering. Yeah, prehistoric human times.
Can you elaborate? I'm lost right now.
Hunting, gathering. I mean, can you elaborate?
During the historical times, the hunters, the gatherers.
We were hunting animals.
Yes.
And women were gathering some plants.
Yes.
This is hunting, gathering period of human society. Until 10,000 years ago. 10,000 years ago, there became a human revolution. Human being set up in villages. Okay? This is agriculture revolution. So, human history is about, I mean, Homo sapiens history is about 150,000 years. Probably 100,000 years. Okay? So, 90,000 years were about hunting-gathering activities. Just 10,000 years, the last of 10,000 years, we came into the agriculture and then industrial period, and we are living in electronic age.
Yeah.
So, this is the human history. What I want to say is this. Actually, I forgot what I want to say. What are we talking
about? Thinking.
Thinking.
Yes.
Thinking.
I mean, the things we see, do we see them because of the blind spot?
Good. Thank you very much. So, when you get into the hunting-gathering period, and if suppose that you are a hunter, and you are chasing an animal. What kind of feeling do you have? Is this feeling is different from the feeling from a person or from a person's feeling about the animal? You know, the same animal differs from according to human period or the environment. For example, a cow. If you become a hunter, the perception or sight is in accordance with the your position. Okay? Now, you are intellectual, you are student, but cow means a different style. I hope you understand. The perception develops according to your position, your living conditions, your age, your profession, your activities, in your age that you live. Maybe during the, for example, 50,000 years ago, a cow was seen to you as a respectful animal. Today, cow means to be eaten very easily, to be consumed. You are going to supermarket and you see much meat. Maybe it is the meat of cow, and you buy and you consume it. So your points of view is very different from the points of view of the hunter-gathering society.
So thinking differs from period to period. How about from one person to another?
Yes, good question. At some level, there are some subjective feelings which are beneficial for your sight or perception. But remember that thinking is not only about position that any person plays. What I want to say is this. You are here and you are listening to a lesson. And probably before coming to lesson, your thinking about thinking is very different. Was different from thinking here. Okay? So there can be some kind of changes when you come into a classroom and talk about thinking. So, I want to say that, what I want to say is that the more you experience some things, the more your perception or sight can change. And at this point we should ask the meaning of experience. What does it mean, experience? And in this paper I give an example. What was my example? I gave this example from Ram, Akira Kurosawa's movies. Ram. Did you remember it? What was the topic of the movie? There was a king whose name is Tudoro, something like this. And after a while, he feels that he will retire from his position. And he divides three parts, his country, three parts. And he has three sons, elder son, middle son, and little son. And he gave the big part to the elder son, and the small part was given to the small son. So he was betrayed by the elder son, After this betrayal, he started to see the reality. And I gave an example about the situation. He was looking at the sky. And he was lying down, he was looking at the sky like this, and he said that, "Look, what a beautiful sky. I have never seen the sky before like this." So the sky is over there, okay? The sky was standing as it is before. Now the meaning of sky has changed. How was it possible? How is it possible? Because of the changing of his perception. He experienced or he recognized the sky as it is. Is there any meaning of the sky?
The sky, could it be like an eye-opener for him?
Sorry?
Eye-opener. Do you know what eye-opener is?
Eye-opener.
Do you know what eye-opener is?
Yes, I know.
Yeah,
I remember. Eye-opener. The sky opened his eyes.
I think.
Yes. But not only sky, but also other things can open his skies because, can open his eyes because, remember that he was betrayed by his son. So before his eye opened, he was surrounded by his passions, his prejudices, his passion of power. This passion of power was his cage, was his cave. Okay, He was surrounded by shadows. He was surrounded by his passion of power. He was surrounded by his prejudices against some things. That is why he couldn't see the sky as it is. That is why he couldn't see the objects as they are. I hope you got it.
Yes.
And he started to think after betrayal. This is thinking. He started to think. He began to think.
He began
before, before this event, he was thinking like automatically. He was supposed
subconscious.
Subconscious level, and also he was supposing that everything was normal. He was doing many actions, and he was harming everybody. He was destroying every places. He was murdering, but he was thinking that this murdering, this destroying, this kind of violence was normal. He was not thinking before. Okay? There was a turning point in his life coming from betrayal of his elder son.
When that he starts to realize the real life without his power.
Sorry?
At that time, mm-hmm. when he look at the sky, he starts to recognize, to understand the real world without his power.
Mm-hmm.
Power of
yes.
cruel, I think.
Power was hampering him, was surrounding him. It was a kind of shadow, you know. It was a kind of cage. Or cave allegory, you know, remember? So he destroyed the cave by seeing some facts. This is the thinking, yes.
So from what you said most of us human beings, we are subconscious.
Yes.
Of our surrounding. And does it mean being conscious, or finally moving from the stage of subconsciousness to consciousness, is a form of salvation?
I'm not saying like this. Actually, what I want to say is that you should notice that we are divided: subconscious level, conscious level. And if you know that. If you notice that, you can be surrounded by shadows, you can correct yourself. Okay? But many people are not aware of this fact, and they think that some things are normal. They don't recognize themselves. They don't know themselves. They don't ask this question: who am I? Who am I? We are here today. We are working, we are studying on a specific issue, and by working on this issue, you can ask this question: who am I? Okay? After this question, is it possible that to make mistakes less? Okay? Without mistake, our life is impossible. We will make mistakes in the future as well. Our normal life is designed according to subconscious level. I learned from many things from the brain book. In Turkish, it was translated into like "brain," but you can read the English version, "brain." It is a popular book. I mean, it is bestseller.
It's written by?
I try to remember his name, But after the lesson, I can give it its name.
Brain.
Mm-hmm. Brain. So, remember that we were mentioning about the meaning of consciousness and subconsciousness, differences between them. And I believe that thinking starts with thinking over some things. Did you understand?
Thinking
starts with thinking over some things.
Yeah.
I mean, we need to change our automatic behavior, automatic perception, automatic sight, if we see some things as they are, as they are. What is really important is this. And at this point, cinema comes up. I think cinema can present some things in a different way, in a different viewpoints. What does it mean? In real life, we think that we see many things. These things are missing in our sight. But in cinema, because of some cinematic techniques, like long shot, close up, middle shot, light, sound, as well as narrative, color, we see things as they are. There are some options for us. Let me give an example. We are here at this room, and we are studying on a lesson, and you are listening to me. But when I am talking here, actually I cannot see Ümit, which means in front of the camera, the person. So how can it possible to see Ümit as he is? Ümit is here, is over there. And cinema, by cinema, by cutting, by montage, by different angles, cinema can present us or show us Ümit as he is. And also, even though we are studying here, actually we are not seeing our faces very much. Our faces carry out small details. But when I look at your eyes, your faces, it is impossible to see these minor details. How can I see these minor details? By camera. Camera, by close-ups, can present the details of your face. Remember the first lesson. I gave an example from a cinema scene. Film scene. I mean, Alain Badiou's example. Do you remember this scene, smiling scene? I mean, the crucified lovers.
Yeah.
And I mentioned that in this scene, the woman and the man was smiling with each other. But without camera, it was impossible to see these minor details on their faces. Camera changed points of view and revealed many things. Cinema not only records some things, but also reveals many things. Okay? And this is one of the most important possibilities of cinema that give us to our age. I mean, give to us in our age. In automatic responses, we cannot see many things. So cinema can give an option for us to see some things in detail. Do you have any question about this issue? Actually, we will come back this issue later. But I wanted to point out this issue. You should pay attention to this issue in order to perceive the relationship between cinema and philosophy. So, now I'm going to your question. Aesthetic regime, ethic regime, ethical regime, and other kinds of regimes. In order to understand cinema, we should benefit from some ideas from the film philosophers. Maybe you remember Rancière, Jacques Rancière, but you haven't read the paper, that is why you don't remember. But I advise you to read the paper before coming here, otherwise impossible, it is impossible to perceive many things.
Okay.
It is heavy issue. So, Jacques Rancière, what is cinema? Jacques Rancière, French philosopher, says that cinema is a paradox. Actually, cinema is a paradoxical art. What is paradoxical art? What does it mean? I mean, by saying paradox. Can you explain the meaning of paradox in English? Paradox. What do you understand when you hear paradox?
Paradox.
Yeah, paradox.
I can't elaborate it, Abdullah.
Don't shift it to me.
Even in your language, probably you cannot explain the meaning of paradox.
I think so.
Yes. I believe that even Turkish students cannot explain the meaning of paradox in Turkish. But I can explain it.
Okay.
Paradox means rupture.
Rupture.
Yeah, rupture. Do you know the meaning of rupture? Split.
Mm-hmm.
Split. There can be some kind of ruptures between some things. On the one hand, some things exist, on the other hand, something exists, and sometimes there are some paradoxes between them. There is some kind of rupture between them. It is paradox. Okay?
Okay.
So it means that in cinema there is a rupture. In images there are some ruptures. What kind of ruptures? When you are watching cinema, any film, you witness some different images. Some of them are cliché images and some of them are different images. What are cliché images? You expect to see some things, remember. You expect to see something. It doesn't make any surprise on you. Okay?
Okay.
When you see them, you are not amazed, you are not surprised, you are not shocked. This is cliché images. In Hollywood movies, generally, you can face this kind of images. A woman and a man meet on the road. They are in folly with each other. And after a while, they get married. This is cliché story. And also the techniques, I mean cinematic techniques, are expected. Okay? In Hollywood movies, you know, there are many cuts. Long shot cannot be seen a lot in Hollywood movies. Because it can be boring for some people. But in the United States, people would like to see fast things. Their life is fast, very fast. They are in hurry. Even their meal is fast food.
Yeah.
Now that life is very fast, the movies has to be fast. Movies are in accordance with the fast life. In line with the past life. It is interesting, huh?
Very interesting.
Very interesting. So when you read a story, you expect something's happening. Did you hear, did you read the Little Prince story? Little Prince. It is a very famous story. It is a book which was written during the 1940s, I think.
A fairy tale?
Some kind of. Little Prince. Have you read Little Prince?
No, sir.
Okay. So.
I read.
And what is the topic of Little Prince?
It's a little prince that comes to Earth and faces with a snake. Let me start like this. First, a man is talking about his life. One day his plane, or I think plane, has mm-hmm. broken down, and he wants to make it, he wants to fix it. And the story begins from that, and it's a conversation between the little prince and the snake, wolf, and I think there is another animal. And they told the prince, they answered the prince's questions about their lives and with their experiences.
In Little Prince, you are right. In Little Prince, there are some expected and unexpected things at the same time. There is some kind of in connection with the reality. On the other hand, it is not in connection with the reality. Reality and unreality is by side by. Okay. So it is a combination of reality and unreality. Expected and unexpected things. That means paradox. There is a paradox here. But even though in the simple Hollywood movies that you have watched can be seen some paradoxes. You know fairy tales, okay? You have read or you have heard some fairy tales, and there is some beginning of the story, an epilogue, prologue, and the end of the story. But there is minor some unexpected things occurred in the story. These unexpected things means that even in the simple stories, you can find some different images. Different things. Cliché images and also different images are side by side. Okay? Cinema means paradox in this sense.
The rapture of expected
yes.
and unexpected events.
Yeah. But in some movies, paradox is very wide. It's very wide. Whereas in some movies, the paradox is very narrow, you know, narrow. In some movies, you can say that, when you are watching some movies, you can say that, okay, I cannot understand the topic of the movie, I cannot understand the meaning of the images. Why? Because in these movies, different images are full of. And because of these images, you cannot be paralyzed, and you can be shocked, and you cannot understand. You cannot give any meaning to images. What I want to say is this: cinema is a paradoxical art, but some movies are more paradoxical than others. So we can classify movies under three categories, in my opinion. One category is thinking movies, or intensified thinking movies. Because thinking is intensified or massive in these movies. Do you remember this kind of movies that you have watched? Do you have seen? Did you have see any movie which is very intensified thinking? Have you ever seen any movie like this?
I've watched a movie of recent in the cinema. I can't really remember the name, but it's last year, and it's about some aliens that descended into the world, and
Arrival.
So when I watched the movie, I felt like I wasted my time. I didn't understand anything.
Actually, I wanted to watch it, but unfortunately, I didn't have a chance to see it. But after your conversation, I will immediately watch it. So, did you see it?
No, I didn't watch Arrival.
So, have you ever seen any movie which shocked you?
I saw a movie, I don't think it's new, but I don't remember the name. It was a guy, the movie is about a dream. He slept, and then that's how the movie started. I don't understand if it's reality, if he's dreaming, if it's... I never understood that movie, but I don't remember the name.
So you are mixed between reality and unreality.
Exactly. Yeah.
Mm. Maybe you are not sure whether or not this is dream.
Okay.
You are not sure whether this dream is or not. Intensified thinking movies. And also there is a second category.
Thinking and intensified thinking is the same category?
Yes, I think so. Some people say these kind of movies, they call it... art movie or art house movie, art movie. But I am against this idea, this conception, this term. Why? Because when you say art, and when you try to make a separation between art and non-art, this problem occurs. By making a movie, you are making an art. Making movie means making art. Okay? Yes. Movies are art. I mean, film is an art. So you cannot think non-art movie. Because remember that in the first lesson we said that cinema is a kind of combination of different elements. What kind of elements? Light, sound, color, narrative, actors, screenplay.
Yes.
So you are get together them. You are combine them. It means art.
Sorry to cut you. I think, I do not know, but from what I understood, the art house movies, what they are trying to say, some people, is, you know, when you say art, it has to, when you look at it, it shouldn't be something that you should just get the point, you should just understand, okay, this is what this is. I think they took that idea to movies. So if a movie is something, like you say, is just cliche, and you just understand, you can predict till the end what it happens, so they do not consider that movie as an art. Like the movie I just said, you have to like sit down and think, or maybe even watch it the second time. So they think this is an art house movie. I think, contrary to your thinking, this is what I think they are trying to say from an art house movie.
Many people can think that when you are watching movie, it is a kind of entertainment rather than art. But it is not subjective feeling, it is an objective thing. When you make a movie, it is an art. There are some conceptions about art. Some philosophers or aesthetics theorists say that art starts from the top. From the top. What does it mean? You have some ideas, you have some intentions, and these ideas are full of thinking. For example, you are a painter, and as a painter, you have some ideas. For example, you want to objectify some humanity feelings, okay? Humanity. Freedom. You should focus on freedom. And you are painting a subject which is related to freedom. And when you pay attention to paint, you can say that, okay, there is the meaning of the painting is something like this. And you can make a comment on about it, okay? This is another art conception. But art is not only about aristocracy or top. Art also is in connection with the real life and also starts from the below. Starts from the below. I mean, from the daily life. We are here, we are talking about something that camera is recording us. When you put camera in front of us and when you do not do anything, it is not art. Why? Because you just put the camera and there is a position of camera. You cannot intervene in anything. You just sit down behind the camera. Camera records everything. But if you add some sound, some light, some color, and you can put some ideas inside it, you have an intention by making a movie. For example, you are dealing with love. You are dealing with love. And you have a love conception, you know, before movie. You have what kind of love conceptions? There are many love conceptions around the world. Probably you are watching Hollywood movies. And this love conception is different from the conception that the love conception in France, for example, or in your country. So this is art.
And how about pure art and impure art when it comes to cinema?
Pure?
Pure and impure.
Ah, okay. So, you are taking some impure things, raw materials, raw, and you are working on them. You are trying to purify them, purify. But no matter how much you deal with purifying them, nevertheless, there can be some kind of impure things, some raw materials. Even though in the most intensified thinking movies, you can find these impure materials. Okay? But in intensified thinking movies, impure materials are lesser than popular movies. Did you understand?
Can you give like maybe an example?
For example, sex. In real life, you know, it is the human part. I mean, sex is human part, human life part. But in real life, you can face the naked bodies, raw, it is raw material, raw. But when you take naked bodies into the cinema, you should purify them. You should aestheticize them. You don't need to show the naked body as it is. Okay? There are many ways of purifying them.
Okay.
I hope I understand.
Yes.
Uh, And also, for example, you are using cars, you are driving cars, okay? But in Hollywood movies, how can you see cars? Cars, you know, are cliche images. You are chasing someone, and cars are driving very fast. You should drive cars very fast. They are used in order to reach someone, in order to catch someone. But in Iranian movie, like Abbas Kiarostami, yeah, Iranian movie director, used car in a different way. When you watch the test of cherry, when you watch the test of cherry, you can face the car as a place in which some people give a speech. It is a place. It is a speech place. You are just addressing some things to others, and they are listening to you, and you are discussing some matters. When you are driving, you are giving some speech. Okay? So, car is used in a different way in his movies. Okay? So, you can purify the car. Did you understand?
I think I have a rough idea of what you're trying to say.
But in the future, lessons, we will back it again.
Okay.
I hope you got it. Cinema is a paradoxical art, because on the one hand there are some cliché images, on the other hand some different images, and they are combined with each other. Actually, thinking moments are related to different images. I asked a question to you. When did you notice your computer? When did you pay attention to your computer? You said that when my computer broke down, I noticed it. This is a thinking moment. In cinema, there are some thinking moments, okay?
Okay.
So these called thinking moments refer to thinking rather than opinion. So Jacques Rancière claims that cinema is a paradoxical art because in cinema there are three kinds of regimes. What kind of regimes? Do you remember them?
Yeah, the aesthetical regime.
Aesthetical regime.
The ethnic regime.
Ethical regime.
And I can't remember the title.
And representational regime.
Yeah.
Representational regime, aesthetic regime, and ethical regime. And to start with representational regime, it means that it is narrative. It is like story. You have read many stories. You have read many fables. Once upon a time, there was a man whose name is such something like this,
yes.
And he had three sons. He divided his country three parts. You know, his story goes on. This is representational regime. Why? Because there is a story. There is a story, and you cannot find unexpected things. Okay? The beginning, the development, and the ending of the story. But also in cinema, aesthetic regime. There is an aesthetic regime. What does it mean? Aesthetic regime means that when you start to think on someone or some things, it means aesthetic regime. Different things. in the story there are some moments where the story goes on different way. Remember the crucified loves. The smiling moment is a different style of people.
Yes.
So this is aesthetic regime. Did you understand? The smiling of lovers refers to aesthetic regime. Why? Because it shows us that emerging society will be like this. Emerging society, okay, next society will be smiling society. This moment is aesthetic regime.
So it was not something expected in the movie, right?
Yes. You should focus on, and you should pay attention to them. Actually, it is like shining point, shining thing. When you look at your memory, probably there are some shining moments in your memory. Shining moments in your memory. In Africa, in Turkey, and you cannot forget these kind of things very easily. Because these things are different from the routine things. About what is the meaning of ethical regime? Ethical regime. Ethical regime is about right or wrong, right or wrong. In every message, in every story, there are some human conditions which brings the meaning of wrong and right. It is about morality, it is about ethics. For example, you have watched Arrival, and in your thinking, what do you think about the right and wrong in the Arrival? Did you notice some things? Or any movie you have watched, right or wrong issue?
I need to pick a movie right now.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
I have one Iranian movie. Its name is I'm Her Husband.
Iranian movie.
Yes.
Who is director?
I think Milani, but I'm not sure.
Okay.
In that movie, the man is a doctor and has a wife with two children.
Mm-hmm.
Instead of that, he has a secretary, and they are in love with each other.
Mm-hmm.
And finally, chaos, he recognized that it's time for him to. It's time for him to. What can I say? This sahiplenme in English. To show the others that woman is his wife. Mm? And I think it can show the ethical points of the movies. And as I read this. Notes, chaos is also written in this part.
Mm-hmm.
And with the chaos skin, he recognizes his ranks and come back again to his real life with his wife.
Mm-hmm.
And it has some ethical problems.
So when you need to make a choice between some things, it is ethical dilemma. Okay? It is ethical dilemma. In the movies, you can face this kind of dilemmas. What can I do? The actors or stars are asking these kind of questions. What can I do? What should I do? Should I divorce from my wife, for example? Should I should I continue my marriage, for example? This is ethical choice. In movies, you can face this kind of things. So three combinations are side by side: ethical regime, representational regime, and aesthetic regime are inside the movies. All movies, in all movies,
sorry,
including popular movies.
Sorry, we were talking about. You said movies can be classified into three.
Yes.
You mentioned just one, which is intensified thinking movies.
Yeah, intensified thinking movies, and the second one is popular movies. Actually, I am not against this term, popular movies. Sorry, I should correct myself, because I get used to using the standard terms. I should change my term. Mass movie. Instead of using popular movie, we should say mass movie. Why? What is the difference between mass movie and popular movie?
Popular, it has to be famous and watched by.
Famous, yes.
Mass.
Nowadays, when you hear popular, you can understand that this thing must be popular, and also this thing must be watched or heard by millions of people. But some terms are changing their meanings over time. When you go back 50 years ago or 30 years ago, the meaning of popular was different from the meaning of popular today. And during that time, popular means a kind of resistance to some things. Resistance. What does it mean? Actually, there are three kinds of culture. One type of culture is folk culture. Folk culture.
Folk.
Yes. In rural area, in villages, you can meet this kind of culture, folk culture. I mean, you produce some things and you consume them. You are doing two kinds of activities by yourself. By producing and by consuming, you are trying to survive. You are raising your cows, animals, sheep, and you are milking, and you are making yogurt, and you are consuming this yogurt.
Okay.
Okay, this is folk culture. But when you go to city, okay, an urban area, how can you make a yogurt? In urban area, how can you make a yogurt?
You have to buy.
What? Okay, you can go to supermarket, there is one option. But the second option, you can buy milk.
Yes.
From where?
Are you talking about milk you can buy from the supermarket, and you can also buy from the herdsman?
Herdsman, yeah. Where do you find herdsman?
In the rural area.
In the rural area. Or maybe around the city, there are some herdsmen who raise the animals, huh?
Yes.
Yeah.
Maybe in the neighborhood, there are some men who are crying, milk, milk, milk. And you can take a bowl and fill the milk, and you can eat and make a yogurt at home. This is popular culture. This is popular culture. Why? Because it is combination. It is combination of folk culture
and
mass culture.
So popular culture.
Mass culture means going to supermarket and buy some things. You don't make an effort to buy some things. You just pay money.
That is mass.
This is mass culture.
Mass culture.
It is industrialized culture. It is standardized culture. Okay? Everything is designed by the culture industries or other industries. Industry is in front of you. And everything is can be determined by them, by industries. This is mass culture. Popular culture is hybrid culture. Now, hybrid or hybrid? Hybrid.
Hybrid.
Sorry. Hybrid culture. Sometimes pronunciation is different.
Yeah.
Actually we should add another culture. This is, how can I say, intellectual culture or high culture. Highly intellectual culture. Highly artistic culture. Philosophers, you know, are dealing with highly intellectual things. Painters, cinema directors are dealing with art. Their culture is different from popular culture, mass culture, and to some extent level popular culture, folk culture. But by saying this, high culture is different from other culture. It doesn't mean that there is totally separation. There is no such a thing. Okay? You can carry some culture elements and you can purify them. You can purify them. No matter how much you climb the ladder, nevertheless, you can depend on the folk culture, or popular culture, or mass culture. Every culture is mixed with each other. I'm saying this kind of things, I am classifying this kind of things because of the analytical separation. Analytical separation requires to make a separation, okay? It is like abstraction. It is generalization, totalization. I hope you got it.
No, I didn't get the last point.
I mean, imagine that you belong to high culture.
Okay.
But it doesn't mean that you separate yourself from other cultures. Mm. You are in connection with folk culture to some extent level.
Okay, I get it now.
Okay. So, why did I say, why did I classify this culture? Because of the separation of movies.
Yes.
So, instead of saying popular movies, I think we should call these movies as mass movies. They are very fast, they are full of cliché images, and unexpected things are weak, less than intensified movies, and everybody can consume it, everybody can watch Batman, Superman, you know?
Yeah.
It is very easy to see them. But it is very difficult to see intensified movies.
Yeah.
And the third classification I made a separation between what kind of third or three or four, two?
Is it three?
I am not sure.
Three.
Three.
Okay. So actually, I wasn't thinking before this conversation, but I put popular movies between mass movies and intensified movies. So it means that popular movies are in between, are in between mass movies and intensified thinking movies, like the yogurt, making yogurt.
So it
doesn't need to be famous of describing popular movies. It is like hybrid movie. Probably in your country, I'm not sure, but in Turkey there are some directors who made films which are related to popular movies. For example, I can explain. I can state that Ümit Ünal's movies. There is a movie of him. Is Nar, in English Nar.
Pomegranate.
If I didn't know it. So you should watch it. It is, in some way, it is similar to intensified thinking movie, but in another point, when you look at the movie in different point of angle, you can call it mass movie. I mean, there are some cliche images inside it, and there is a paradox inside it. It is not easy to classify these movies, but over time you can be sure what kind of movies are they. I mean, you can describe them. You can get used to watching movies in order to classify these movies.
In some movies, we see the producer shows the low class of people's lives and their problems. In which category are there?
Can you explain?
In some movies, we see that the producer shows us the low class of people's life and their life's problem.
Mm-hmm.
Are there mass movies or thinking?
What is important is not topic of the movie. What is important is the method of showing the images. I mean, how can I show the low class of people? How? Okay.
For example,
cinematic techniques and idea can be sight by sight.
The last film I've seen is one of the Iran movies, The Life and the One Day.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. In that movie, they also show what I says, the low class of people's life and their problems.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Mm-hmm. They can show the life of problems or life problems of people. But let me repeat again. What is important is to show how.
How.
Okay.
Yes.